Okay, so it is really a pleasure to have distinguished Professor Moti Segev to close our 2021 seminars. First and foremost, Moti is a patriot who came back home from Princeton to Technion 20 years ago to support science in Israel. His fundamental and diverse breakthrough in optics earned him too many awards to go over. I would just mention his election to the American National Academy of Sciences and the Israel Prize in Physics and Chemistry. Perhaps the most significant contribution that a researcher can make is nurturing the next generation. And indeed, more than 20 of Moti's former students are now professors around the world. And he is known here for his support at young faculty at Technion. Beyond science, I can tell you personally that Moti is a mensch that will always make time for a young faculty or a friend. And he's also a great partner for beers. Moti, please go ahead.
Thank you. So I'm going to tell you today, first of all, I wish it was a real conference. I don't like Zoom conferences, but it's okay. We can manage during these difficult times. So what I'm going to tell you today a little bit about is topological photonics and with a particular twist of topological insulator lasers. So the work that the people that worked on that between 2013 and now, some of them have become professors. It all started with an idea that two of my people suggested. One of them is Michael Rechtsman, who is now associate professor at Penn State. And the other one is Jonathan Plotnik, that is in the industry right now. So they worked on it from the very beginning on the first paper. And after that, there was a bigger and bigger team worked on it. Among them, Jakob Lumer and Miguel Bandres, who is now a professor at Creole in the United States, Gal Harari, Zhaozhu Yang, who is now assistant professor in China, and my current students, Eran Lustig, Alex Dikopoltsev, Moshe Ishai Cohen, and Liat Nemirovsky. We collaborate on different stages. At the beginning, we collaborate with Alex Tzamait, who is a professor in Rostock, her professor, Dr. Alyusha. Alex was also my postdoc years back, 10 years back. And on the topological insulator laser, we collaborated with Mercedes Kajavikan and Dimitri Stodolides, and the student Stefan Witek from the United States, from Creole, UCF. On the more recent work on the topological VCSEL, we collaborate with Sebastian Klemt, Sven Offling from Würzburg in Germany. And on the quantum part, we collaborated with Andrea Blanco Redondo and with Ben Egerton, at that time from Australia, now she's in the United States. So I would like to start this by giving you some glimpse of what are the main concepts of topological physics, topological insulators. There are many ways to approach this. Some of them are mathematics, and some of them come from condensed matter, and I like to give it at the fingertips. So topological insulators, in one line, they are materials or systems that are insulators in the bulk, but are perfect conductors on the edge. Most importantly, the transport on the edge is topologically protected. What does it mean? It means that we have some, let's say, 2D material. The bulk is an insulator, and then you have supercurrent on the edge. What it means that the current on the edge is scattering less. So you put disorder or put sharp corners or any junk you wish, the current will continue to circulate and will not scatter into the bulk and will not scatter back. Okay. The idea was proposed, the first idea was proposed in 1988 by Duncan Aldane from Princeton. Duncan is a mathematical physicist. So what he did is assume an Hamiltonian with no particular relation to any physical system. And I used to actually disregard or look down on these kind of ideas because they did not relate to physics. They seemed to be mathematics oriented. But actually I was wrong. It took 18 years until Charlie Kane came up with a particular system and proposed how to observe topological insulators. Not exactly what Aldane proposed, because Aldane did not propose a physical system, so not exactly that, but closely related. And within several months, Shusheng Zheng from Stanford proposed a slightly different system. And within a year, there was the first experiment by Lawrence Mollenkamp from the University of Würzburg. Now, if you go back to the concept, so the concept is such that it's an insulator in the bulk. Well, there are many materials that are insulators in the bulk, and there is supercurrent on the edge. So just to highlight the idea of a supercurrent or scatter-free current on the edge, what does it mean? So let's suppose that we have some perturbation, whether it's disorder or sharp corner or something, some different potential that looks like this. now comes a wave, classical or quantum. Normally, part of that is scattered, reflected, part of that is transmitted. If it's two-dimensional, then you're looking at also scattering sideways. So we are familiar, especially people like myself from nonlinear optics and several others like John Dudley and Kostas Makris and several others that are here in the audience that I saw early on. And there are some scattering-less potentials, but they have to be very, very specific. For example, a hyperbolic second squared is a scattering-less potential, reflection-less potential. We know it because it's related to solitons. But here, we are talking about scattering from junk, from disorder, from sharp corners, from edges. So how can you avoid scattering from potential that the shape can be anything, can be random? So, okay, so the idea is that you make sure that the density of states or the state to scatter into does not exist. If I want to translate it into the language of condensed metaphysics, the density of states right here, of the states to scatter into, is zero. Okay, that's really the first beginning of the concept, the first building block of the concept. That immediately relates to some kind of a band gap. It turns out a band gap is related to a periodic system. It turns out this is not necessarily so, that you can have topological insulators in systems that are quasi-periodic, like quasi-crystals, and also in systems that are amorphous, and also in systems that are fractal. We have, for example, we have now a paper that we had a theory paper that proposed topological insulators in fractal systems against all kinds of experiments that were done in the past and mindset. That was published last year, but now we had a paper that was under review in a major journal, and with the experiment, the major journal rejected it, so we had to transfer it, to send it to another major journal by the name of Science, and hopefully there it will be accepted. But so these concepts are really deeply rooted. So again, going back to the system, so we are looking at a system that, that there is a region of parameters or the region of values where there's no states to scatter into. That's really the first building block. So that gives the notion of a band gap. So let's think about a band gap. So let's take a two-dimensional system, like the two-dimensional material that I had before, periodic in X and Y, and we have a band gap. This is a trivial band gap. It's not a topological insulator. And now let's put some magnetic field on top of it. And let's see what happens. The magnetic field immediately generates or exerts Lorentz force. So if you think about the electrons, as if they are waves, okay, and they are in the vicinity of the atoms, of the latticides, then we are looking at a system that looks like this. Now, anywhere where you sit, when you reside in the lattice, in the bulk of the lattice, the currents cancel out. So from that, you understand why the system is an insulator. Not of this, not because of this, but because the currents cancel out. Okay, and then you look at what happens on the edge. Well, on the edge, we have current because outside it, it's a different material. Could be vacuum, ordinary material, or whatever. And so here the transport is by hopping. You can't really go the way you are in the bulk, but you can hop from side to side. It is unidirectional because in order to propagate in the other direction, what you need is to switch either the polarity of the magnetic field or the spin of the electron. So it will be unidirectional. So it explains why there is current on the edge and explains why there is no current in the bulk. But it does not explain why you have topological robustness, why you don't scatter when you put disorder or you put sharp corners. In order to understand that, what you need is to look at the dispersion curve. So it turns out that the dispersion curve of the edge states is this red line. So what do we see in the red line? First of all, we see that it's only one direction, that there is no counter red line on the other side. The other thing that we see is that the slope is finite. It's never zero and never infinity. That has major, major implications. All topological edge states in all topological insulators in the world, those that were observed and those that are still in the notebooks of the condensed matter theorists, all of them, the edge states, the topological edge states, always have group velocity. They cannot have zero group velocity, and they also cannot have infinite group velocity. They always have group velocity, finite group velocity. The other thing that you see is now, let's imagine that we launch a wave packet right here in the middle of the band gap. And now we start to put perturbations and we ask ourselves, what will the perturbation do? So scattering backwards, you cannot, because there's no counter line on the other direction. So what can happen is that you distort a little bit the local neighborhood, so a little bit the bends and a little bit this curve, but you cannot avoid it. You will have to stay on this curve. You can move up and down the curve and that's it. So what will happen to it is that as long as your scattering potential is smaller than half the band gap, you cannot couple to the bends and you cannot scatter back. So you will stay on this line, which means that you will always follow, continue to have transport on the edge, unaffected by disorder or sharp corners or defects, as long as this disorder or whatever does not, cannot bridge the gap. In other words, it needs to be smaller than half the band gap. Well, we are familiar with this effect. It's called the integer quantum Hall effect, for which von Klintzing won the Nobel Prize already. It was discovered in experiment 1980. So what is all the fuss about topological insulator? Well, first of all, the integer quantum Hall effect today is included in the large family of topological insulators. But the whole fuss is about finding a system where the same effects happen without any magnetic field. Somehow this one is intuitive. Without magnetic field, it's much less intuitive. Okay? But still, there are several effects that can do it. So there are several others. So what did we learn? There are several other issues there. So the first issue is that if you want to characterize, to ask what are the features of topological insulators, you have unidirectional edge conductance. It's immune. The edge transport is immune to scattering and defects. No back scattering, no scattering to the bulk. And the last one is an interesting one. It turns out that there is one more quantity that is a conserved quantity. That quantity is called the winding number or the Chern number. What does it mean? The way to understand it is to look at the wave functions. It turns out that in topological systems like the one that I described to you right now, the wave functions behave like a Mobius ring. Okay, let's say this one is Mobius ring turned once. So the winding number is one or minus one. This one is Mobius ring with two turns. So this is here, the winding number or Chern number is two. So now think about trying to interface material between this and ordinary material where the wave functions simply close the loop, close the ring, and go back to the original phase. What will happen now is that those materials do not interface very well because you will need to have an interface where on one side of it, it will behave like this. It belongs half to this material. And on the other side, you need to belong to ordinary material or the interface between these two. Okay. So this is why the edge functions are really sitting in the gap where there are no bulk solutions and they are engineered in such a way that the edge states belong half here and half here. And this is why the topological quantity of the number of turns in this supposedly Mobius ring that I illustrated for one-dimensional systems have this conserved quantity. In the language of the Nobel talk that Duncan Alden has given, then you can take a material that has this feature and try to do adiabatic deformations. So, for example, if you are thinking about a cup that has an ear that you can hold it, you can deform it to all kinds of things that they will always have a hole in the center, but you will never be able to deform it adiabatically to a sphere or an egg because the sphere or the egg have topological winding number of zero and the cup has topological winding number of one. Not really, this is a nice illustration because we don't know what is the phase of the wave function on the cup, but never mind it. So topological insulators require some mechanism to make it happen. So the integer quantum Hall effect add external magnetic field, but there are many, many other mechanisms known today. The one that Lawrence Mollenkamp used is very strong spin orbit interaction, which is a fermionic effect, or as was discovered later on, time modulation, other mechanisms. I want to emphasize that here, size actually matters. It actually matters a lot. Why is that? Because the size of the band gap determines the robustness. So if I go back a bit, remember this, you need to be, in order to be, to have topological protection of transport, what you need to have band gap here that is as large as possible, the larger the better, because a very, very small band gap will immediately create, every little junk will couple you to the bulk and you'll have scattering into the bulk. And this is what you want to avoid. So the story goes that immediately after the first experiment, people started to think about, can we take these ideas, these concepts, to bosonic systems? In other words, the first topological insulators to be proposed, this one was discovered in experiment, requires magnetic field, and this one is a fermionic feature, spin orbit interaction. In bosons, you don't really normally have spin orbit interaction, not in the way at least that fermions have. So people ask, what will happen in a more general case? Is this whole concept of topological insulators, is it unique to fermions or can it be generalized? The first one to ask this kind of questions is again Duncan Aldain, who again wrote a concept paper that said assume an Hamiltonian. Years later, I talked to Duncan at some meeting in Tel Aviv, and he admitted that there is only one line that is important in this paper, that if you deal with bosonic systems, normally you will need to break time reversal symmetry. So I told you that the paper was a bit hard to follow or hard to think about it and take it to a physical system, but it was, so the paper sat for 3 years on the archive before it got published in PRL, but there was one person that was able to take the ideas one step forward, and that idea is, that person is Marin Soljačić, my former student who is a professor of physics at MIT. He came up immediately after Duncan, he came up with an idea on how to do, on designing a system to observe it in electromagnetism. And a year later, they had their paper in Nature with the first experiment outside the domain of condensed matter physics. Now, what's the story? The story is that Marin understood that you need to break time reversal symmetry. Well, in electromagnetism, the way to do it is to use the Faraday effect. So he designed a system that is a photonic crystal in two dimensions, and then every rod here is a gyro optic material that has a Faraday effect that breaks time reversal. Now, there is one important issue here. Important issue is that magneto-optic effects are extremely small at optical frequencies, actually from terahertz and higher. There is deep reason to that. You can read about it in Landau Lifshitz of electrodynamics in continuous media, but generally speaking, it has to do with the fine structure constant, and it also has to do with the ratio between the electric dipole and the magnetic dipole of the atom. Put it differently, and the magneto-optic effects are weak. We know it, all photonics people know it, and this is why we need for optical isolators to use strong magnetic fields and long samples. The optical isolators cannot be the size of a quarter wavelength. They need to have many wavelengths of propagation. So Mari knew it, so he took this experiment into the microwave region where the magneto-optic effects are large. And what you see is the two-dimensional magneto-optic photonic crystal with magneto-optic rods, okay? And the lattice constant is 4 centimeters, which corresponds to half wavelength, more or less. And what you can see here is a defect. And you can see from the experiment what happens to the edge states. So the edge states go only along the edge in one direction. And then when they come to this disturbance, they go around it, and there's no scattering to the bulk and no scattering back. Well, this is a very nice idea, but how to bring this idea into photonics or into the regime of infrared optics and so forth. So before I tell you how, you should ask why. And the reason is deep. In microwaves, you have antennas. Antennas do not relate really to atoms. If you want to have light matter interaction at the level of atoms and molecules, certainly at room temperature, you better do it at optical frequencies. And again, the problem is that at optical frequencies, the magneto-optic response is very weak. So the topological band gap is so small, you don't have protection. So if you don't have protection, then you lose all your nice features, and everything scatters. So why do it? And so here, there was some, between Marin's experiment in 2009 and the first observation, there were several years, and people tried to come up with creative ideas. And there were quite a few of them. I will not mention them now. At that time, my group, we were looking at the ideas, and we didn't like any of them, okay, at that time. So we tried to invent an idea of our own. Luckily enough, two of my students, Jonathan Plotnik and Mick Rechtsman, went to a faculty retreat where a young colleague of mine, Netanel Lindner, had a student presented Netanel's work. And the idea is as follows. Let's suppose that you have a system that has some Hamiltonian that you modulate it periodically in time. So try to calculate periodically in time. It means that the eigenstates, it's a linear system, so the eigenstates will be Fluke modes. So let's look at the dispersion curve of the Fluke modes. What does it mean? It means like, let's look at the relation between energy and momentum for an observer that resides on the modulation, the periodicity of the modulation. And let's start with a system that has a band gap, a real band gap. So you have a real band gap, and now you ask yourself, okay, let's start to modulating and see what happens. So then when you do that and you start modulating, then the band gap closes a little. And if you go to higher frequency, the band gap closes more. At high enough frequency, the band gap completely closes. And if you go beyond that, a new band gap opens, which will now be a topological band gap, and you'll have topological eight states in between. So this is the idea. So the next idea was, okay, and that idea was generated by Netanel Lindner, but you can see that it took a lot of time to publish. So by the time the paper appeared in Nature Physics, an ordinary paper in PRB with much less results was published by the group of Eugene Demler at that time, with some other friends, Erez Berg and Mark Radner. Anyway, so next idea after that is, actually, why start with a material that has a trivial band gap? Why not start with a material that has no band gap at all? Well, such material is graphene. So I can take graphene, look near the Dirac point, and start modulating. In graphene, every little modulation, no matter how low is the frequency, will open a band gap. So you don't need to fight against the trivial band gap. You can start with there's no band gap and just adjust the frequency. And indeed, there was a theoretical prediction to make in this way, to make a topological insulator in this way in graphene. Well, they actually did it, but 1 year after us. So we heard this idea, inspired by this, we went and created a system in topological photonics. And now this is a detour of one slide to topological photonics. Imagine that you have a piece of bulk material, let's say like glass, and you launch inside it a laser beam, okay? And a monochromatic laser beam that has a given frequency omega, some discrete frequency. And now what we want is to look what happens for that beam, where the beam does not change too much on the scale of a single wavelength. So what will happen is that we can write the beam as an envelope multiplying a carrier. The carrier is just a plane wave. And we reach an equation that we call the paraxial wave equation, okay? That looks like this. And you ask yourself, what does it mean? Well, the paraxial wave equation looks one-to-one mathematically, exactly mathematically equivalent to the Schrödinger equation from quantum mechanics, with one big difference. In quantum mechanics, the evolution of a quantum particle is in time, and you can have here a potential that is in XYZ. In paraxial optics or spatial photonics, the evolution, time is taken, it's all, everything is a monochromatic. So the evolution here is along the propagation XZ, and what you are looking at is a potential that can can change in XYZ. Now, if it changes in Z, that means that the potential changes also in time. Okay, so by looking at different plane in the propagation direction Z, plane in X and Y along the propagation direction Z is equivalent to looking at later and later times for a quantum particle, quantum wave packet. So with this in mind, okay, we designed a Fluke topological insulator. So what we did, we designed a system of waveguides, optical fibers that are designed to sit on the vertices of a honeycomb lattice like graphene, okay? So instead of modulating in time, now we modulate in the Z direction. It looks like this, the waveguides are helical or like this, they are like springs like this. All of them have the same helicity with neonizon. In other words, they have the same phase and they also have the same periodicity. And they sit at the vertices of this. This is a photograph from the input phase of our device. You can see that each one of these ellipses is a waveguide. They are elliptic because of fabrication issues, but what matters is the coupling between nearest neighbors. And what the experiment that we envision is trying to launch something on the edge, and when you launch a topological edge state, it will reach the other edge and then bend down and go around and around. Or if you put some perturbation, it will never scatter to the left, but actually continue along its course. And this is a little movie from the experiments that were done by Miguel Bandres, who joined the group after this paper. And since we cannot image into the material, we can image only the output. So what we see here is what happens at the output phase when we change the position of the launch beam. So we launch the beam at the beginning here, and then we move the launch beam more further and further. And you can see how the output, the light at the output phase, crawls on the edge and then goes down without scattering into the bulk and scattering back. And at that time of the experiment, after seeing this data, my students wanted it to submit to Nature because they understood it's important. And I said, no, not yet. I want one more experiment because I want to show explicitly the robustness. So we fabricated another piece like this, and by the group of Alex Samite, who actually fabricated and did this particular experiment. And what you have here is a system that has less than 30 unit cells. And here there is a missing waveguide. The light was launched here, and never mind that the system was so small, still most of the power reached to the other side. So the light that was launched here was able to bypass a huge defect, like a missing site, and reach to the other side. So with this, we submitted it to Nature, and that was some argument with one of the editors that at the beginning was not sure to send it out for review. After we persuaded her, she did send it out to review. The paper was accepted right away, and the rest is history. That paper now is about 2,500 citations, and it launched the field of topological photonics. Several months after us, Mohammad Hafezi from the University of Maryland published a related paper on a different model, different topological model, and he had a paper on viewing chiral edge states in silicon photonics. Turns out that his model is actually more useful than ours whenever you want to have something that is on a chip to actually make devices out of it. In his paper here, he just saw it. A year later, he showed robustness that is similar to ours. Today, we are 8 years after. So I can classify very roughly all photonic topological insulators can be classified more or less into six classes. This is the one that was that requires breaking time reverse asymmetry, which I said that this is why it's good mostly for microwaves, but not for photonics. This is one that is suggested by Gennady Spetz. It requires B anisotropic materials. There is a related one to it that has to do with, it's called Valley Hall. The Valley Hall one is applicative to optics, but this one is much less because it requires B anisotropic metamaterials, require the presence of metals usually, which means absorption. If there is a lot of absorption, then you can't really talk about long distance transport. So you can't really, the robustness means much less. So this is why this is mostly good for microwaves. This is the one that we used in 2013, and we still use this for other things. For example, for looking at high dimensional systems and so forth. High dimensional, I mean 3D and 4D. And this is the one by Hafezi. I'll get back to it later. This is the one that is called the crystalline model, invented by Wu and Hu, brought to photonics by Wu and Hu, two Chinese people that are researchers in Japan. And before that, it was invented in condensed matter by a guy by the name of Fu. And this is the one that was invented by Yidong Chong, my scientific grandson. He was a student of Marin. It is really related to strongly coupled systems. Okay. So here comes the story that after we had the first paper, we said, okay, my students wanted to generate more and more emulations of ideas from condensed matter physics that cannot be done. Either are impossible, I would say, in the real world, or are extremely hard to explore in condensed matter physics. And I said, I don't mind that, we can do it, but I want to do also something different. And it relates to my personal view on experimental research. So, well, we made the first topological, photonic topological insulator. But one can say that we knew the outcome in advance, so why not study it just numerically or analytically? Why do this kind of experiments? Why do we need these experiments at all? This relates to an argument that I had with Michael Berry, Sir Michael Berry, who is a very good friend of mine, but we had this argument for about 15 years. Michael used to say that these experiments are demonstration experiments and are nice, but we don't learn much from them. And we argued for 15 years, and in 2012 I won the argument, not because of me, but because Serge Haroche won the Nobel Prize for something that, where the solution was known. And the deep reason that I won the argument is deep. It goes like this. Physics is an experimental science. When you do numerics or analytics, everything is given. You have the equation of motion, you explore it under some boundary conditions or initial conditions. Everything that you want is contained, all the physics is contained in the equation and in the boundary or initial conditions. When you do experiments, what you're trying to do is to isolate your system from the rest of the world, make sure that your experimental system follows some rule like that, let's say some equation of motion, and the initial conditions or boundary conditions follow what you want to explore. But in doing that, in trying to isolate your system, you learn a lot because you learn about additional effects and what they do. And you can never really fully isolate your system from the rest of the world. This is why when you do experiments, much more than numerics, you come by new ideas, you ask yourself tough questions, and you often also have surprises. And today I'll talk about one big surprise or a nice idea that came from the experiments. And that is our work on topological insulator lasers. So what are topological insulator lasers? Just imagine that we take the system that I just told you about, or any of the topological model, and try to put a little laser in every vertex, at every site. So every waveguide like this, a fiber or every site, will be a little laser. So and then you want to bring this into the realm of topological insulators. When I had this idea, the motivation was modest. All I wanted to do is to have some lasers with rough edges and to look at lasers with defects and disorder. I knew that I'm going to have to argue fundamental issues with my friends, the theorists from condensed matter. Now, why is that? Because lasers are non-emission systems. Non-emission systems, can they support topological insulators? At that time, in 2013, 14, 15, it was believed to be impossible. In fact, there are still papers published in high journals like PRX to say that to this day, there are no non-emission topological insulators in two dimensions at all, okay? So we knew that we are going to have to argue with the whole community. The reason that they say it is actually deep. Non-emission systems do not conserve energy, do not conserve momentum. So why the heck should they conserve to some strange feature like the topological winding number or chair number? The other issues that we know that we'll be infringing on fundamental issues is, think about it, of having topologically protected transport in a system with gain. That means that if you have a little bit of scattering, evanescent scattering, the gain can amplify it, and then you lose all your protection. So why should it work ever? And the last one, at that time, when we started this, all topological insulators that were discussed in the theory were linear systems. So it had conserved quantities, but lasers are fundamentally highly nonlinear systems, because they require all lasers gain saturation. Without gain saturation, there is no lasers. So we knew that we'll be infringing also on this concept. What this one was, one could actually accept, maybe there is a topological insulator that is nonlinear, slightly nonlinear maybe, perturbatively nonlinear, but the other two were a big no-no, and some are dead today. So what I missed, and back then when I thought about this idea, is the killer application. And the killer application was to use the ideas of topological transport to force very many little laser emitters or semiconductor lasers to operate together and lock in phase to make them coherently coupled, locked to a first, to act like a single laser. We proposed this vision for the first time in CLIO 2016. We submitted a student paper, first author Harari, and the committee upgraded it to an invited talk, which was given by Gal Harari, by my student. And then there was a very lively discussion pursued. And what I said there in response to some of the questions was, do not go for magneto-optic effects because your band gap will be tiny. Not everybody listens. Okay? I want to tell you that in order to get to the lasers, we had to do first steps into non-Hermitian systems. And the first one was an idea that was proposed by Mick Rechtsman, was my postdoc. And he suggested, let's look at a simple topological system of one dimension. It's not a topological insulator, but it is, and let's make it non-Hermitian with gain and loss, or with loss and larger loss. And let's see if we can learn something. He was relying on a theory paper that said that sometimes you can extract the topological constants of a 1D system from the loss, okay? And so we did that. And the first author here is a student of Alex Tsamait, who was actually leading the work. And a little bit after that, a year later, there was an idea that was generated by several people. I think one of them is Kostas Makris, you see him here, who was a postdoc of my good friend, Dimitri Stotolides. And there are several other partners here. And this is another paper that was led by Alex Tsamait, my former postdoc. And what we looked here is in topologically protected bound states in a parity time symmetric, in a PT system, also non-Hermitian, but PT symmetric. There was a big debate about this because people thought they are impossible. Actually, you can find papers that say that they cannot exist. They are PRL papers, okay? And that led us naturally to put our feet into the water a little bit, or put our hands into the non-hermeticity with topology. Notice that these two are one-dimensional systems. They are not topological insulators. So there's a huge gap when you take this and you want to jump to a topological insulator. And this is the talk that I was talking about. Now, since I knew that we are going to confront the condensed matter theorists, then what I did is I suggested that we take the archetypical model, the one that was proposed by Dakin and Aldane back in 1988, because we have to hit them where it is credible. Otherwise, if we come with some photonic models, they will not believe us. So better we argue in their own territory. So we took the Aldane model as it is, and we put at every vertex of the Aldane model, at every lattice site, it's tight binding, we put a little laser. In reality, what does it mean? It means that we take a lattice that is a honeycomb lattice with nearest neighbor coupling, and then second nearest neighbor coupling. And in every vertex, we put a little ring laser. Okay, this is a photograph of a ring laser that was actually made by Mercedes Kajavikan, who collaborated with us. The secret here is that you have the next nearest neighbor coupling has some phase, non-reciprocal phase. It's called the Aldane flux. When the Aldane flux is zero, when the phase is zero, or pi, then what you have is a trivial system, that is topological trivial system, no band gap, edge states to go forward and backward are degenerate. But when the Aldane phase is not zero and not pi, but something else, and topological band gap opens, and then you have edge states. For the upper edge, it goes to the right, lower edge goes to the left. But the lattice remains the same Bravais lattice. So if we can just play with the phase, we can compare the two on every other parameter. Just playing with the phase, and let's see what happens. So we started here with the theory. So the first thing that we did, we set up the equation. So we looked at a particular equation. We assumed everything is paraxial. So we looked at the evolution here. The lattice, this is the Aldane potential, Aldane lattice. We put linear loss, but if you put saturable loss, it gives you just the same thing. And then we put saturable gain. So this is really a three-level laser system, homogeneously broadened. A four-level laser system, but homogeneously broadened. It doesn't matter if you make it inhomogeneous, it also works. And there is a little bit of computational problem of finding the correct ones by using outgoing boundary conditions. Never mind that. If you're interested in technicalities, I'll tell you later what you need to do. And then we designed it as a triangle with some output port, and we pump the edge. Why? Because we want to make sure that what lasers first is the edge mode, the topological edge mode. And we started with some random seeding, which emulates the spontaneous emission noise, okay? And we asked what will be the dynamics. That the first thing that we did, we find the eigenmodes, okay? So below, if you are looking below threshold, below any saturation and so forth, you can find the eigenmodes because the system is linear. And if you ignore the saturation completely, you can calculate the threshold. All the nonlinearity of the laser comes into play only from the threshold and higher up. Up until the threshold, the system can be assumed to be linear and it's perfectly fine. So we found the eigenmodes. So what you see here is is the eigenmodes, and what we are looking at is actually the imaginary part of the eigenenergy, or if you wish, okay? And this will tell you how much loss or how much gain you have. Zero is Lasing threshold. And the modes that are in this region and this region are the bulk modes, and in between, you have the gap modes. So when we start with no amplification at all, what you get is the lossiest are the edge modes. Why? Because the edge modes are in the gap. They are the lossiest, they radiate the maximum. And then we start to put gain on the edge. So as you start to put gain, these modes to become gain, acquire gain longer, higher and higher, until one of them lasers. It reaches the threshold and starts to lase. Okay, how does it look in the simulation? So you start with some random seeding, you let it evolve in time until it reaches steady state. Why it reaches steady state? Because of the subtle nature of nonlinearity, or the nonlinear nature of the gain. So you start with something and you let it evolve in time until it stabilizes, and it always stabilizes. So what we are interested is to know how the system works. The first thing is to ask, is it a laser or not? So what you see here is what happens as a function of gain. Every point here is 100 different simulations, and they start with different random seeding because we want to make sure that you don't by chance excite something weird. Okay, you need to do ensemble average. So you can see that below, this is where the threshold is. Below the threshold, the buff threshold, we have like any laser. We have this famous knee right here. And then we are interested in the threshold and in the slope velocity. This is the results of a tight binding simulation that we did. We started in random seeding. And this is, we put a defect right here. Okay? So we start with random seed and let the system run. But the system starts to run, to evolve in time, until it stabilizes to steady state. What you see in steady state is the following. It will run again and again and again. What you see is that if you start from here, the intensity goes up and up and up, and then you reach a defect, then the edge mode, the optical wave, will go around the defect. In doing that, it penetrates into the region that is absorbing, is not pumped. Everything here is a resonant material. So everything here that is not pumped is absorbing. So you can see how the intensity here goes down, then it goes high again, and it goes all around. And by the time it comes here to the output port, part of it goes out. So the intensity inside the cavity, the resonator drops, and then continues along the route. Notice that this edge mode cannot escape the output port because of this group velocity that it has. No topological edge mode can escape the output port. Why? It has to move. It cannot be localized, okay? So it has to move. That's one thing that is very important. The other one, that it's able to bypass a defect. Let's compare it. We did many such simulations, and let's compare it to what happens if you set the al dente to zero, so the cavity is trivial. So the immediate thing that comes to mind is that the mode that lasers here and is able to avoid the output. So light does not come from the output. The second thing is that as you introduce disorder, every realization of the disorder will give you slightly different lasing mode. Okay, the lasing mode will be mostly on the edge because this is where you pump. But the structure of the lasing mode here and here will be different. And here what you see is this region and this region are completely disconnected. So they will lase in different frequencies and different shapes and so on and so forth. So what we saw here is that the topology affects two things. One of them is the shape of the lasing mode. The other one is the ability to actually extract output, laser output. So the next thing is that we looked at is the efficiency. So what we see, so this is the efficiency of the lasing as a function of disorder strength, which is scaled to the size of the band gap. So disorder strength one corresponds to disorder amplitude, scattering amplitude, that is the size of the band gap. And what you see is that the topological resonator is always about 50 times higher efficiency. So you can see that the mean here is this thick line. And what you see is the results of all the simulations. So every realization of the under disorder will be always much stronger than the trivial one. The trivial one is right here at the very bottom. Okay? And what you can see here is what happens is different realizations of the disorder. Different realization of disorder means different lasing modes, different frequencies, different shapes, different regions that lase. Practically speaking, what happens here is that small groups of lasers lock together independently of the rest. And the reason that it happens is because the lasing mode is not forced to go all along the lasers that are available. Whereas for the topological one, the lasing mode has non-zero go velocity. So therefore, it forces its way through all the resonators on the edge, and it forces them and locks them together, forces them to appear in a deterministic phase from one another. So they are really locked together, injection locked together. Okay. The next thing that we wanted to look at is what happens to the lasing mode in terms of spectrum, okay? So we started with here at the threshold, and now we start to increase the gain more and more and more. And what you see is that 10 times above the threshold, which is a very good result in terms of applications of lasers, the lasing mode remains a single mode. So if you zoom into it, you'll see why. Okay, you see that the lasing mode remains right here at the threshold, like any laser. The lasing mode remains on the threshold. All others get a bit higher amplification, but never reach the threshold. And the reason is because the pumping here is on the edge, and all the lasing modes on the edge have the same population. The difference between this mode and this mode is the relative phase between them, between neighbors. But practically all of them occupy all the entire edge. So once one of them lasers, it saturates the gain for all of them without any additional assumptions. So if I compare this to the trivial one has many, many modes. So the spectrum, we expect the spectrum to be very different, very broad, and so on and so forth. So with this idea, so what did we learn here? We learned that the topological insulator laser forces injection locking of all resonators associated with the lasing mode, topological edge mode. Topo laser has much higher stop efficiency, favors single mode lasing, and its robust to imperfections and fluctuations in the resonators. This is a crucial issue, because when you come to think about it, and you want to fabricate an array of 100 lasers, they will never be exactly the same. And even they are, if they are exactly the same, the thermal conditions are not exactly the same, so on and so forth. So we took this result and we wrapped it up, sent it to Nature, and it was sent out for review, theory paper, yes, came back from review. The three referees did not believe it. The editor, however, did believe it. So Carl Zimmel is the editor, told me, look, Moti, they don't believe it. Try to have experiments. Once you have experiments, send it back to us, and hopefully it will fly, because they thought it's important, but they just did not believe the theory. I said, well, Carl, with all the due respect, I will take the experiments and I will send two papers back to back to Science, which is exactly what I did. So this was published back to back with the experimental paper in Science. So how did we do experiments? We went and talked to Dimitris Todolides and Mercedes Kajavikan, and she fabricated the first topological insulator laser for us. And the experiments were done in her lab by my former postdoc Miguel Bandres and by her student Stefan Wittek. And this is how it looks. It looks like a square like this, and every laser is a ring, and the connections are in these ellipses. Okay, it was done optically pumped at that time. And so what did we design? We built on the model proposed and demonstrated by Hafezi. So what is the Hafezi model? Only the Hafezi did it for passive systems without gain and loss at all. So it was never controversial, whereas ours was. So let's suppose that you have two ring cavities that look like this, okay? And so each one of them has a set of resonances. They are identical, so the set of Fabry-Perot resonances are the same. And now we want to connect them with two branches with the different path lengths between them, because we want to phase shift. So let's connect them with this and this with different length. How is this done in reality? By placing an ellipse, creating an ellipse that connects it, and then moving the center of the ellipse slightly up, fractions of a wavelength up. This will create a symmetry in the upper branch and the lower branch. So let's say that now you have a phase shift of 2 phi between the upper and lower branch. Now you take this and you make a first row of phase shift of 2 phi, and then another row of 3 phi, another row of 4 phi, and so on and so forth. Now, if you go around a plaquette, you will see that you are left with a phase of 2 phi. And that actually behaves as if there is an artificial gauge field that is exactly like what would have happened in a fermionic system of electrons under the influence of a DC magnetic field. So this was what we had in mind. This is the Hafezi model, only that what we did, every circle like this was actually a laser, a ring laser, and every connector was an ellipse that was shifted slightly up to have a phase shift. Okay, and we ideally we didn't want it to laze. We couldn't control it much because we could not really pump only the lasers, so which hurt our results a little bit, but still it was good enough. The first experiments were presented in January of 2017 in the NanoMeta conference. Some of you remember it, I think. And it's the first bench of successful fabrication. And what you see here is that the topological laser lased only on the edge. The trivial laser lased a little bit only inside, also inside. And you see that the stop efficiency of topological laser is 4 times higher. This was not good enough to my taste. So a month later, Mercedes fabricated intentional defects. So what you see here is defects that she fabricated. And you can see already here nicely is that when you pump them, then the topological laser for the same pumping is much more bright than the trivial one. So efficiency is much higher. And we looked at the spectrum here. And I can tell you, I don't have a slide handy, but the spectrum here was single mode. The spectrum here was broad. So the next thing after this was still not good enough, in my opinion, to write as a theory paper. So we went for another batch of experiments. And this time we added output couplers right here. Okay. And what we said now is the following. If this is an idea that was cooked between Mercedes and Miguel. So what we said is the following. If it is indeed a topological edge mounted lasers, then we can pump far away from the output couplers right here. And then because of the non-zero group velocity, the light will travel and will measure something at the output. Indeed, when we do it for the topological platform, we see a very nice curve of laser. When we do it for the trivial one, when we pump just this, light never reaches the output because the group velocity can be zero. So localized groups of little emitters, little localized groups of 2 or 3 lasers lasers independently, okay, but never reach the output coupler. So, but what happens then? So we said, okay, so we cannot get light out for the trivial one when we pump just here. So let's pump all 4 sides. We pump it, we do see something coming out of the output coupler, which is this much lower group, much lower efficiency, even though here we pump all 4 sides, and for the topological one, we pump only the far edge. Well, so the next question that is called for is what happens in topological one when you pump all 4 sides. Remember this? Remember this figure? It is here. This is really what happens when you pump all 4 sides. So indeed, the efficiency of the topological laser is much, much higher than the trivial one. So the next thing to examine is the spectrum. So we looked at the spectrum as image the light that is emitted from the ring upwards, a little bit of light that leaks out. And we looked at it from 8 sides and compared it to the spectrum of the light emitted to the output couplers. The topological insulator one always lasers, all the emitters lasers in the same frequency. A trivial laser, sometimes you get this, sometimes you get this. And then we have little groups of lasers that emit differently. So in 2007, with this, we submitted it to Science back to back. The 2 papers were accepted. And I think now, after 3 years, we're looking at the experimental paper is the most cited paper in all photonics. It has close to 700 citations in Google. It created a lot of follow-up. Now, and so one can say that, look, we stood by the promise of the talk that we had, the visionary talk that we had in CLIO 2016. And the vision is to maybe to do it with 1,000 or 10,000 lasers together, the talk together as one. The only problem is that you need to take the light out, not to scatter, but to extract the light out. How would you do it? When you want to do it from a chip, like the ones with the ring lasers, then your output coupler becomes a bottleneck. So you need to think about slightly different way to get the light out. So the natural thing and the way to do it is to use VCSELs. This brings me to the other part and said the more recent work. Okay, so let's try to think if we can make a topological insulator, vertical cavity, a vertically emitting laser array. Okay, so that's what we did. We looked at VCSELs and we tried to get them to get out, and this appeared in Science about 2 months ago, a bit less than 2 months ago. What is a VCSEL? A VCSEL is Today, the most commonly used laser, just a moment, most commonly used laser in the world, the most commercially sold laser. Okay, why? Because people use it on in every cell phone for face recognition, recognition of your fingerprints, and even the mouse of the computer. This mouse also uses it. So it's really a commonly used laser. And what it is really a gain layer sandwiched between two Bragg reflectors, and the light goes out either through the electrodes or through the substrate. The electrodes are here and here, okay? So it goes through them. So when we start to look at for it, look at this, and we start to come up, try to come up with a strategy, with a model, then we immediately crossed out some of the models. For example, all those that require three-dimensional fabrication, we crossed out. It will not work. And the Hafezi model is also not good for that. I can explain exactly why, but generally the idea is that in most of the models, the transport, the coupling of topological transport is in the same direction or the same plane where the light is emitted. This is really the major drawback. So for that reason, we went to the crystalline model, for which the light can be emitted normal to the plane. So we took the crystalline model, and every little one, every little circle like this is a VCSEL, is a vertical cavity surface emitting laser. It lasers towards me. So it lasers from the blackboard and up, or from the blackboard and down. The crystalline model says the following. Let's take two regions of graphene, of honeycomb. One region, let's a bit compress it with respect to the center, and the other region, let's a bit expand it. So it turns out that the compressed lattice, honeycomb lattice, has a trivial band gap. The clean honeycomb lattice has no band gap. It has Dirac points. But when you compress it, then it becomes a trivial band gap. If you stretch it, it opens a topological band gap. The interface between them is the most fascinating, gives you topological edge modes. So that's what we did. We took many VCSELs, and on the outside of it, we compressed them, and the inside, we stretched them. And we looked at the interface. So this shows you a simulation from the design. Actually, the simulation now is not only tight binding, but we did full wave simulation. In other words, we simulated Helmholtz equation. We treated it as a two-dimensional photonic crystal. Okay, again, start from random seeding and let it stabilize in the end on the edge, just like as you just saw. Okay, and then went to fabrication, and we fabricated this region. You can see here the internal and the external are different. One, it's hard to catch because the changes, the differences are tiny. And we do not really etch down, we don't really separate the emitters. Rather, it looks like a 2D photonic lattice. It's not like connectors and lasers, but everything is a photonic lattice, but we provide gain only on these sides like this, okay? So before we did the laser, we wanted to look at the photoluminescence, and we looked at the interface mode from the interface between the stretched and the compressed lattice. What you see is like this. For the compressed lattice, there's no band gap. For the stretch lattice, there's topological band gap. The interface between them gives you lasing and gives you edge mode that emits light. There's a little bit of line here, still not lasing. What it does now is just emits light, but it shows you that there are states right there on the edge. There are edge states. And this is really a photograph that shows you how the light, when you pump it, that the light can actually be emitted from the edge, from the interface between the two. And then we completed the whole circle. This is how the topological VCSEL looks like. This is the emission pattern. There are 30 lasers. We divided them into 12 regions because of the 12 hours on the clock, just notation. Okay. And the pumping glow looked like this. So you can see that we actually pumped the interfaces between them, which is not good. We are now moving to electrical pumping. But at that time, that's what we did. Okay. And this was all done. All the experiments here were done at the University of Pittsburgh by a very talented graduate student by the name of Tristan Harder, and his professor is Sebastian Klemp and Sven Hoflin. And the key player for my group here was Alex Dikopoltsev, who did all the design and interpretation and so forth and analyzed the data. And so really it is a paper by Alex and Tristan, most of it. Anyway, so what you see here, that behaves like a laser, and you can see here the spectrum of what happens comparing to the trivial one. Trivial one is this broad, and the lasing topological one is this. And then we looked at the spectrum of every site, all 12 regions, each one is 3 lasers. As you can see that they all lays in the same spectrum, which is also the spectrum of an individual pixel, which means that the fact that we have coupling between them does not generate us additional frequencies. And then the most important part is that we looked at interference. Why? Because we wanted to measure that all this is actually lasing as a single laser. Interference is the ultimate experiment. So what we did, we created a Mach-Zehnder interferometer. We took the output, we reflected from a mirror, we reflected half the beam. So now we switched left and right and interfered it with the other half of the beam. And what you can see here is what happens to the interference. The first thing that catches the eye is that you have high peaks everywhere. So there is constructive interference everywhere. And then if you zoom in, you'll see the fringes. So this is fringes from region one. Region one is really the 3 lasers that are right here interfering with themselves. So the central one interferes with itself. So the fact that it generates nice fringes is not a surprise. And the one slightly on the right interferes with slightly on the left, which is nice that they interfere. But this one is really the interference of the 3 lasers here with the 3 lasers on the other side, which are about 15 lasers away. And it still shows very nice fringes. This is really the important part. And here we compared it to the trivial array. You can see in trivial array, you have high contrast only here and here. So the lasers from here never interfere, the lasers from here. So if you want to make it in plot it on a plot, the visibility of the interference fringes or the coherence length as a function of distance between the 2 lasers, or the topological one, at least for these 30 lasers, remains flat, irrespective of the distance between pairs of lasers. And from the non-topological one, it goes down exponentially. So what is the reason? These ideas of topological lasers captured actually in the community. There are many, many groups following these. Were just, I mentioned the first ones. There's a group from Singapore led by Kiji Wang and Yidong Chong. And they actually made a topological, electrically pumped, topological insulator quantum cascade laser. Beautiful work published in Nature last year. Another interesting paper is by us, a theory paper predicting to do modlocking of a topological insulator laser. This is a very interesting issue because so far, if you think about arrays of semiconductor laser, the largest that was ever made, fabricated in any platform is 10. It was a commercial system for a little while. And the last paper in my PhD, I did modlocking for 10 emitters. But if you want to go to 12 emitters, you lose all coherence altogether. So here we came up with an idea how to use the fact that we have a large system that acts as one to create modlocking. Still controversial, we don't know if it will happen, but the vision is there. So we hope it will. We are actually working on it. Another one is the topological pixel that I just told you. Another interesting paper is by the group of Carusotto, Jacopo Carusotto, one of the pioneers of topological photonics. And he looked at the theory, at the coherence theory of topological lasers, and these conclusions supported our numerical and experimental results, that the topology actually makes it happen, that all the lasers look together coherently. The drawback of his paper at that time is because it's too hard to simulate an array of semiconductor lasers. Actually, nobody simulates an array of semiconductor lasers in any platform. The largest number that was ever simulated, I think, is 2 or 3. It's computation extremely demanding, and there are no good models for that that will make the computation reasonable. So what he did, instead he used a simple model of a 4-level laser, type class 1 laser. So it doesn't really represent exactly, it's more like theory for neodymium-YAG lasers in a topological platform. So there are still many questions to answer also theoretically, but I think the very fact that it supported the main ideas, I think it's extremely encouraging. There was another paper in Nature Nano, topological bulk laser, And there is a more recent paper by the group of Jabikan and Christodoulidis on the Haldane lattice, which is very interesting. I can go into some nice stories about it. And there are many, many more coming up. And there are many more, and there are quite a few more that were published, also experiments. The vision here was to have thousands of VCSELs lasing collectively phase-locked as a single high-power, highly coherent laser source. I want to take you on a glimpse to some related ideas that are not on lasers, but also in topological photonics. One of them is very exciting, is about topological photonic, photonic topological insulator in synthetic space. The idea actually came from condensed metaphysics, out of where it was suggested out of necessity. And the idea is to use not only XYZ, but to use some additional space like model space or frequency space and so forth. 2019, we created the first photonic topological insulator in synthetic dimensions. So one dimension here was the model dimension. The other one was real space. Very interesting. And more recently is now, in the last Clio, we just finished working on a 3D topological insulator. In other words, it's two dimensions plus one synthetic dimension. Extremely interesting. It is now under review in a famous journal. Another one is an idea that was created by Mick Rechtsman and Nathaniel Lindner, my former postdoc and my young colleague, on using trying to go for a system that is not topological, and then you introduce disorder, becomes topological. It's called topological Anderson insulator. The first one was done in photonics. The ideas were led by Mick Rechtsman and Nathaniel Lindner. The experiments were led by Alex Tsamait. Another one is exciton polariton topological insulator. This was following some nice work done by the group of Jacqueline Bloch, who did it in one dimension and two dimensions, but in one dimension topological systems, SSH lattice or diatomic lattice. And she did something in two dimensions that is not topological, like photonic graphene, and related to the work my group did in 2007 already. But to bring this to two dimensions, it's much harder. So we discussed these ideas with the group of Sven Hofling, and he sent his postdoc at that time, Sebastian Klempt, here to discuss with us. And a year later, Sebastian succeeded in carrying out the tour de force experiments. And here we are talking about a topological insulator that is half light, part light, part matter. It's exciton polariton. It is symbiosis between light and matter. Very interesting. The predictions for that are really, there are two groups that proposed how to do it, exciton polaritons, both of them in 2015. There are many, many remaining challenges. I will list just a few of them that are most interesting to me. But there are many others, including mostly all kinds of nonlinearities in topological photonics. So the first one is topological protection of quantum states. So the idea is the following. In condensed metaphysics, perhaps the most important applications of topological insulators, futuristic application, is by reducing the scattering, maybe you can prolong the coherence time. Okay, and maybe one day have topological, use this for quantum computing. But in photonics, the quantum coherence of entangled states is already is in a system that does not have very, very fast fluctuations. Very fast means that on the order of the optical cycle, then the coherence is maintained, the quantum coherence is maintained. So what help can we get from the topological protection of scattering? So we had an idea on that. We had a concept paper in 2016, and soon after us, Muhammad Hafezi published his. And there are several experiments that are interesting. Some of them, to me, the most interesting one. At the beginning was a paper by Muhammad Hafezi, where he looked at the quantum emitter. It is really, the quantum emitter was generated by the group of Ido Vax, and there is an interface to a topological photonic system on the Hafezi model. And what you see there is that if you have a quantum dot that is emits light of entanglement between two polarizations, then one polarization will go to the right, the other one to the left. Okay, that's the main idea. but it's not topological protection. And about the same year, Andrea Blanco Redondo did the first experiments on looking at topological protection of B photons and the year later of entangled states. But it's still just 1D. 1D is not very interesting. We need to take it all to 2D, and there's not enough work on quantum features, the quantum topological photonics. Another one is an unresolved theoretical issue, topological invariants, topological insulators in non-emission systems. There's a big debate. There are several papers, let's say like this one, that found actually families of topological insulators that are in non-emission systems. On the other hand, there is a contradicting paper published in PRX that says that at least in 2D, there are no topological non-emission systems. And the beauty here is not in the eyes of the beholder, but actually it has concrete questions. Another one is an interesting challenge of topological insulator nano laser. Never done, it's conceptual, because you cannot use some of the ideas that I showed you. And the last one is to take the whole system of topological insulators to higher dimensions. So we already succeeded in 3D. It's a paper that we have now under review in a famous journal, but we want to shoot for four dimension, which will be the first four dimensional experiments in physics. And it's still a challenge, and we hope to be the first to do this one. And I want to end this talk by saying, look, what we really do is we study universal physics with tools of optics. Optics is fascinating, or electromagnetism is fascinating, but many, many times we have an impact not only on photonics, but a lot beyond it. Some of that has to do with all kinds of crazy models in physics that were proposed, but some of them actually are completely new ideas that emerge from the photonics and go out. And there are many of those that have been able to catch, some in condensed matter, some in cold atoms, some in acoustics, some in all kinds of systems. We are after those that are conceptually mind-boggling. Thank you for listening. And I'm always looking forward for having good postdocs and good students. So if you have talented people, please have them contact me. Thank you.
Thank you, Moti, for the interesting and extensive talk. Are there any questions? I'm sure there are. Maybe for Makris.